Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of America, 1908, The Dawn of Flight, The Race to the Pole, The Invention of the Model T, and The Making of a Modern Nation, by Jim Rasenberger, narrated by James Jenner, and directed by Lynn Flanagan. This book is copyrighted 2007 by Jim Rasenberger. This recording is copyrighted 2008 by Recorded Books. 1908 was a time of seemingly boundless innovation. Everything was bigger, better, faster, and greater than ever before. Shedding new light on stories we thought we knew and telling fresh stories we can't believe we never heard, Jim Rasenberger gives us this rousing chronicle of a country on the brink of greatness, and a timely, thought-provoking glimpse at a younger America, even as we wonder what awaits us in the century ahead. And now, America, 1908.
Prologue. Leap Year. Any book that hopes to convince its readers that a particular year of America's past was pivotal, that it was the year that changed everything, or the year that made America, or some such grandiose claim, is suspect at the outset. History doesn't fit neatly into the annual cycles of the Gregorian calendar. A year isn't a historical category. It's a cosmological event, a single revolution of the Earth around the Sun, 365 spins on its polar axis. Or, in the case of 1908, a leap year, 366. With that in mind, here's a more modest claim. 1908, by whatever quirk of history or cosmology, was one hell of a ride around the sun. It began at midnight on January 1st, 1908, when a 700-pound electric ball fell from the flagpole atop the New York Times building, the first ever ball drop in Times Square, and ended December 31st, 1908, with a 2.5-hour flight by Wilbur Wright, the longest ever made in an airplane. In the days between, the great white fleet sailed around the world. Admiral Robert Peary began his conquest of the North Pole. Dr. Frederick Cook reached the North Pole, or claimed to. Six automobiles set out on a 20,000-mile race from New York City to Paris via the frozen Bering Strait. And the New York Giants battled the Chicago Cubs in one of the strangest and most thrilling seasons in the history of baseball. Most dramatically, in the spring of 1908, then again in late summer, the Wright brothers proved to the world they'd mastered the skies. The Wrights had first flown at Kitty Hawk in 1903, but not until August and September of 1908, during a series of simultaneous aerial demonstrations at Fort Myer, Virginia, Orville, and Le Mans, France, Wilbur, did America and the rest of the world truly grasp what they had accomplished. That September was, quite simply, one of the most astonishing months in modern history. A few weeks after Orville Wright's flight trials ended spectacularly and tragically at Fort Myer, an automobile called the Model T went into production at Henry Ford's Piquette Avenue plant in Detroit, Michigan. The Model T very soon transformed not only the automotive industry, but in turn, almost every aspect of how Americans lived and worked. Ford's automobile arrived more quietly than the Wrights' airplane, but its impact on the daily lives of most Americans was more immediate and far greater. Whole books could be written about each of the events that made 1908 remarkable. Whole books have been written about a few of them. This book considers the events not as discrete moments, though, but as pieces of a larger picture, which is to say, as they were considered by those who lived through them. whether practically significant, like the launch of the Model T, or essentially frivolous, like the automobile race around the world, an act of splendid folly, one of the contestants called it. All reflected and expanded American's sense of what was possible. Only in retrospect would it be easy to distinguish between the credible and incredible. Yes, it was absurd for someone to expect to drive an automobile across the ice of the Bering Strait. But no more absurd, at the start of 1908, than someone proposing to fly an airplane for 2.5 hours. Even barring extravagant claims about 1908, there is no doubt that the America that emerged from the year was different than the one that went into it, and was, in many ways, defined by it for years to come. Buoyed by achievements, the country was more confident in its genius and resourcefulness, not to mention its military might, and more comfortable in assuming its destiny in global affairs. That destiny would be made manifest 9 years later, when America entered World War I and changed the course of both the war and the world. For the moment, it was enough to know that America was singularly equipped to lead the world into the 20th century. The America in which the following stories occurred will be, in scattered glimpses, familiar to readers of 2008. If we squint, we might even mistake it for our own. There were 46 states in 1908, nearly the full deck. Oklahoma had just been admitted to the Union, 1907, and Arizona and New Mexico were next, 1912. Alaska and Hawaii were still half a century from statehood. But the basic geography of the country we know was drawn and settled. In the cities, middle-class life had assumed some of the shapes and contours of modernity familiar to us. People rode subways to work, lit their homes with electricity, and spoke on the telephone. Many others vacuumed their floors with vacuum cleaners and washed their clothes with washing machines. And all lived surrounded by products whose brand names we recognize. Kellogg's and Nabisco, Coca-Cola and Pepsi, Gillette and Hoover, Budweiser and Pabst, Ford and Buick, among many others. Though still years away from radio and decades from television, they enjoyed their leisure much as we do. The more affluent disported themselves with tennis and golf. The less affluent preferred baseball and flocked to ballparks in record numbers to watch their champions battle for glory. Movies were very new, but already immensely popular. Over the previous few years, Nickelodeons had sprung up in every small town around the country, from Florida to Alaska. Americans of 1908 were fascinated, like us, by technology, including wireless technology of the sort being developed at the time by Guglielmo Marconi and Lee DeForest. They anticipated the day when people would walk around with telephones attached to their ears, and when voices and images would whisk through the air across continents and oceans. They paid attention to their diets, read newspaper ads touting advances in plastic surgery, worried that Christmas was becoming too commercialized, that the environment was being ravaged, and that life was speeding up and passing them by. They tried to slow life down by reaching for an Eastman Kodak Brownie camera and taking a snapshot. One other thing Americans of 1908 shared with those of us who live in 2008 was a presidential election. They were coming off 2 terms of a Republican president who would abruptly set their country on a new course. Like our current outgoing president, theirs was a wealthy Ivy League-educated Easterner who had gone west as a young man and made himself into a cowboy. Like ours, theirs had entered the White House without having won the popular vote. In their case, it was an assassination that brought the president into office. Then conducted himself with unapologetic swagger. There the comparison between Theodore Roosevelt and George Walker Bush ends. The differences between the two men are far more telling than the similarities. But for the people, it was clear then, as it is now, that the country was heading into a new world defined by as yet unwritten rules, and that the man about to exit office bore some responsibility for this. Like our respective presidents, we are, for all we hold in common with our predecessors of a century ago, more different than we are the same. For one thing, there were a lot less of them than there are of us. The population of America in 1908 was 87 million, compared to our current 300 million. They looked different than we do, too, and not just in how they dressed and wore their hair. They were, as a group, lighter-skinned. Nearly 90% were Caucasian, and though a recent wave of immigrants from Eastern Europe and Southern Italy was shading their whiteness to a slightly swarthier hue, they remained blindingly pale. They were younger, too. The average life expectancy for a Caucasian was about 49 years. For an African American, 35 years. Millions died early of infectious diseases. Another 35,000 died in industrial accidents. Most of these casualties came from the working class and the poor, including the nearly 2 million children who labored in coal mines, steel mills, and other dangerous occupations. Theirs was a country of extreme divisions and disparities. Between the small numbers of the very rich, the 2% who possessed 60% of the nation's wealth, and the vast ranks of the poor. Between whites, who were reflexively and almost uniformly racist, and blacks, who were severely discriminated against, and were forbidden by law in 26 states to marry a white person. The division between men and women, too, was stark. The sexes lived in separate realms, if not always in practice, then at least in theory. Men worked, women did not. Men were strong, women were weak. Men enjoyed sex, women did not. That was the theory, anyway, and many Americans believed it. Finally, no division was more obvious than the one between city and country. Away from the cities, America was still largely rural and pre-modern, lacking electricity or plumbing. More than 50% of Americans lived in rural surroundings, and a third of working-age people made their living from the land. They were often informed by magazines and newspapers that they lived in the age of steel or the machine age, but for most, it was still very much an age of horses and cows. There were more than 20 million horses in the country, nearly one for every four people. The single largest industry in the country wasn't steel or coal or oil, it was meatpacking. The western states that provided much of the nation's beef were no longer wild frontier by 1908, but they were still largely unpopulated. The demographic median of the country was located near the middle of Indiana, several hundred miles east of the Mississippi River. West of the Mississippi, a few mid-sized cities rose from the prairies and the plateaus, but mainly what lay out there was land, and those who meant to profit by it. North Dakota and Montana were still open to homesteaders. Texans were indulging in their oil deposits. The famous Spindletop Gusher had been discovered in 1901. And Arizona and New Mexico were largely unsettled ranch country. Now is a good time to come to Deming, urged a New Mexico newspaper called the Deming Headlight. Land surrounding the town can be gotten for almost a song. If you don't get some of it now, you will regret it 5 years hence. Farther west, Nevada claimed fewer than 80,000 residents, but a gold mining boom was sucking in new settlers and had nearly doubled the population since 1900. Las Vegas was a dusty depot surrounded by desert ranches. Los Angeles was a city of 300,000 people, rich in fruit and oil, and overlorded by Harrison Gray Otis, eccentric publisher of the Los Angeles Times, who had himself chauffeured around town in an automobile with a cannon mounted on its hood. Otis's fellow Los Angelino, William Mulholland, was supervising the construction of a 230-mile aqueduct to ensure a steady supply of water for the future city. Mulholland could hardly have imagined what that city would become after 1908, with its green lawns, swimming pools, and 4 million thirsty citizens, but he went a long way in assuring it. Which brings us back to the stories in this book. The old frontier had been settled by 1908, but the new frontier was nothing less than the future. Americans of 1908 were confident they could achieve dominion over the future, just as they'd achieved dominion over the frontier of the past. Their confidence made them wonderfully ambitious, but a little unhinged. They cherished boundaries as a matter of moral principle, for they were profoundly moralistic people. But they were bursting through every boundary that existed. The last great wave of explorers was setting off to map the last true wildernesses of the world that year. But the borders that defined human possibility, physical and psychological, political and sexual, were vaguer than ever. What was real and solid in this strange new world, where people could fly and buildings could rise to the clouds? Where submarines plunged into the seas and invisible words traveled through the air? Where did plausibility end and fantasy begin? From certain perspectives, America of 1908 resembled Winsor McCay's Little Nemo in Slumberland, the immensely popular comic that appeared inside the New York Herald every Sunday. In each strip, a boy goes to sleep and dreams fantastic adventures, only to wake up in the last panel and return to reality. Reality? The adventures of Little Nemo were only slightly less believable than what was reported on the front pages of the newspapers. According to the press, everything that happened in 1908 was bigger, better, faster, and stranger than anything that had happened before. In part, this was newspaper hyperbole. In part, it was simply true. The world was changing with stunning velocity, as if its very orbit were accelerating. Life was exhilarating, but also disorienting. Under the influence of economic, cultural, and demographic shifts, Americans of all classes and backgrounds found themselves thrashing around in a state of flux. Agitated and edgy, suspicious of each other's motives. The term melting pot entered the American lexicon in the fall of 1908, coined by playwright Israel Zangwill, to define the nation's capacity to absorb and assimilate different ethnicities and cultures. To our ears, the words may sound warm and delicious, like a pot of stew. But to Zangwill, the melting pot was a cauldron, roaring and bubbling, as he wrote, stirring and seething. In the end, for all that was wrong with America in 1908, the most impressive trait shared by its people was the hope that carried them forward. They fiercely believed, not always with good reason, that the future would be better than the present. It's striking, in fact, how much more hopeful Americans were then than we are today. We live in a nation that is safer, healthier, richer, more egalitarian, and less physically taxing than it was in 1908. But a recent Pew poll found that barely one-third of us feels optimistic about the future. Upon being asked whether children growing up in this country would be better off or worse off in the future than people are today, two-thirds of respondents predicted that they will be worse off. If this poll accurately reflects our beliefs, the old truism that Americans are eternally optimistic is apparently no longer true. Of course, we have reason to be less optimistic. We are wiser now to the downsides of those technologies we've inherited from our predecessors. We cannot look at an airplane without knowing the death and destruction, from Dresden to 9/11, that airplanes have wrought. Automobiles may have once promised their owners exhilarating freedoms, but they now deliver traffic jams, addict us to foreign oil. 1908 was the year, coincidentally, that oil was discovered in Iran, and pump doses of carbon dioxide into our atmosphere that will alter the earth in ways few of us dare to imagine. The American pride that sailed with the Great White Fleet on its voyage around the world in 1908 and was met with gratifying adoration at every port is now tempered by the knowledge that much of the world despises us. The next 100 years may be the price we pay for the conveniences and conquests of the last 100. What follows is an attempt to recount the disparate events that Americans of 1908 confronted on their way into their own futures. Confined to a single journey of the Earth around the sun exactly one century ago, it is the story of several smaller journeys, beginning on the first day of the year in New York City with a boy on a bicycle. Part 1. Dementia Americana. Chapter 1. The Boy and the Machine. New Year's Day. A quote from Thomas Edison, 1908. Anything, everything is possible. On the cool, fine afternoon of January 1st, 1908, a 16-year-old boy named Terence Kigo, or Tigo, as several brief accounts had it in the next day's papers, stepped onto his bicycle at his home on West 131st Street and began pedaling down Amsterdam Avenue in the direction of Central Park. Other than his address and his occupation as a clerk, few details about the boy survive. A few more, though, can be surmised. As he started down the wide avenue, descending from Harlem Heights to the valley at 125th Street, he would have passed through a sloping neighborhood of row houses and low apartment buildings occupied by working-class families. Because today was a holiday, and because the weather was pleasant, some of the families would have been out on the avenue, strolling the bluff above the river. Young children would have turned to watch Terence glide by on his bicycle, hunched over his handlebars, cap pulled low on his head, wind pulling at the tail of his coat. Perhaps a few flecks of confetti escaped from the furls of his coat and fluttered out behind him like tiny bright moths. Certainly, Terence had gone out to greet the new year the previous evening. What 16-year-old boy could have resisted the tug of the street? He may have joined the swollen tide of revelers on 125th Street, where the festivities had continued, with occasional interruptions from the police, until nearly dawn. Or, more likely, being a self-supporting and spirited adolescent, the kind of go-getter, according to the next day's New York World, who had made a New Year's vow to take no one's dust when on his bicycle, he'd travel downtown to 42nd Street to cast himself into that great cauldron of humanity that was Times Square on New Year's Eve. Only a few years earlier, well within Terence's young memory, New Year's Eve had been a quiet and civilized affair, spent at home or on the streets of Lower Broadway, where the chimes of Trinity Church rang harmoniously at midnight. These last several years, though, it had metamorphosed into something entirely different. More like an election night bacchanalia, with a bit of Independence Day bumptiousness thrown in, plus some frantic energy all its own. The chimes still rang at the old church downtown, but the action was uptown now, and its pulsating center was right here at the non-sectarian intersection of Broadway and 42nd Street. Arriving in Times Square, Terrence would have climbed directly into a press of bodies and a blizzard of confetti swirling under the dazzling lights of Broadway. The streets had been filling since early in the evening, tens of thousands of bodies funneling in from Union Square in the Flatiron District, from the Tenderloin, still others from the outer boroughs by streetcar or subway or ferry. An acrobat could hardly have managed to fall down for a wager, so tightly did the people hold each other up, reported the next day's New York Evening Sun. A special correspondent for the Chicago Daily Tribune judged the noise in Times Square to be more varied than in previous years. Slide trombones that yowled like a cat in torture, a combination of cowbells and streetcar gongs, tin horns with a double register, sections of iron pipe that could be rasped with files till they gave forth bellows that carried for blocks, were a few of the sounds the correspondent recorded. Shouts and squeals blended with these other sounds to create, as the New York Tribune put it, a terrifying reverberation. To step into that crowd was to release all sense of direction and decorum. It moved as an organic, unruly mass, drifting, lulling, then surging spasmodically. A 16-year-old boy on the last night of 1907 would have been astonished to find himself squeezed in among so many strangers, or more to the point, among so many young women. While the usual distaff armor, overcoats, ankle-length skirts, petticoats, shirt waists, steel-plated corsets, undergarments, did its job of keeping feminine flesh secured, the rules of Victorian modesty lapsed that night. Men and women ground against each other indiscriminately. At every corner, meanwhile, temptation beckoned in the form of vendor carts stocked high with horns and nickel bags of confetti. Assuming you could get to one of these vendors, you could stick a horn into your mouth and stuff your pockets with confetti, all for a dime, then dash back into the swarm to discharge your colored specks into the face of a stranger. More aggressive boys and men squirmed through the crowd with small feather dusters. Ticklers, they were called, brushing the exposed flesh of women's faces and ears, then vanishing before they could be reprimanded or cuffed. Police Commissioner Bingham had issued an edict against the use of ticklers this New Year's Eve, but nobody paid him any mind. Many of the women had taken matters into their own hands, covering their faces with heavy veils to ward off the feathers. Near 42nd Street, a group of enterprising young men pulled a clothesline across the sidewalk, tying one end to an iron post and drawing the other end taut to the curb. When young women approached, they raised the line a foot or two off the pavement. "Leap year, ladies," they called. "Take the jump. Show what you can do for leap year." Some women stepped down onto the street to walk around, but many accepted the challenge. They lifted their skirts above their ankles and jumped. Young men executed most of the pranks that night, but the females were hardly blameless. Groups of them clasped hands to each other's shoulders to form daisy chains, then ran into the crowd, whipping through it with merry violence. Late in the evening, at 46th Street and Broadway, was Terrence there to see it? A dozen young women encircled a well-dressed young man. Locking their arms together, they refused to let him escape. The young man repeatedly tried to bash his way out of their circle, but the young women only pushed him back into the center, taunting and jeering him. A policeman finally rescued the hapless young man, but not before the women had kicked his silk hat down Broadway. What Terrence couldn't have witnessed that night with the diamond-clad women smoking cigarettes inside the glittering precincts of Rector's and Martin's. These two Broadway restaurants, among others, had relaxed their usual restrictions and allowed female patrons to indulge in tobacco. A fact so remarkable, it was recorded on front pages of newspapers around the country. Much as Americans would tune their television sets to watch the ball drop in Times Square in later years, they looked to New York that New Year's Eve for excitement, dismay, and provocation. On the night of the first ever ball drop, New York did not disappoint. Just before midnight, a hush fell over the crowd. All eyes rose to the top of the Times building. Up there, hovering over the city beyond the glare of powerful searchlights, poised at the tip of the 70-foot flagpole, a giant glittering sphere waited to fall. It was 5 feet in diameter, 700 pounds in weight, and cloaked in 216 white lights. Nobody could have guessed they were about to witness the debut of a custom that would still mark the new year a century later. Nor was it likely, at this moment, that anyone was peering so far ahead. It was enough, in the remaining seconds of 1907, to contemplate the difficulties of the year behind and the promises of the year ahead. The crowd began to count backward, tens of thousands of voices rising to the sky above New York, joined together in anticipation of something new and marvelous. Then the gleaming orb fell, and bright white numbers flashed on the roof of the Times building. 1908, 1908, 1908. At the end of the long glide down to 125th Street, Terrence could either pedal furiously to gather speed, then take his chances dodging whatever traffic might be passing along 125th Street, thereby preserving his momentum for the long ascent to Morningside Heights. Or he could veer east on 125th Street. The latter was the easier, more sensible route. The thoroughfare would have been quiet on New Year's Day. A few horses would be standing at the curb before their carts, snorting patiently. An automobile might rumble past, but automobiles were still scarce in Harlem, since not many people living on $15 or $20 a week could afford one. Other than the piles of horse manure, which Terrence would be mindful to dodge, the street promised a smooth ride over macadam. A few effortless blocks, then Terrence would turn south again, skirting Morningside Park. To his right, across the park, rose the stony cliffs of Morningside Heights. Atop them, blotting the weak afternoon sun, loomed the gray walls of St. John the Divine. The great cathedral begun the year Terrence was born, and still in the infancy of its construction. The plain of Jewish Harlem spread out to the east. The road was flat all the way south to Central Park. Terrence's legs would still be fresh when he got there. Had there ever been a finer time to be an American boy on a bicycle than on that first day of the new year of 1908? Certainly, the interests and passions of a 16-year-old had never coincided so perfectly with those of his country. America was very much an adolescent itself, brash and exuberant, stirring with strange and urgent new longings, one moment supremely confident and clever, the next undone by giddiness and hormones. The psychologist G. Stanley Hall had recently coined the term adolescence to describe the passionate new birth that occurred in humans between childhood and maturity. It was, wrote Hall, a phase characterized by storm and stress, but also by joy and delight, as old moorings were broken and a higher level attained. The description fit the America of 1908 as well as it did any teenager. Mainly, what a 16-year-old American boy and his country shared was a sense of their own glorious futures. Only a few months earlier, in October of 1907, a financial panic, the flurry, the papers insisted on calling it, had sent stock prices tumbling and thrown millions of Americans out of work. Already, though, the economy seemed poised to rebound and resume its relentless growth. To an ambitious boy already in possession of a bicycle and a job, the future was limitless. This morning, The World had published an essay to greet the new year in which the paper's editors looked back to the past, then ahead into the future. The title of the piece was simply 1808, 1908, 2008. The World began by noting how far the country had progressed over the previous century. In 1808, 5 years after the Louisiana Purchase and 2 years after Lewis and Clark returned from their transcontinental journey, the country's population was a mere 7 million souls. The federal government was underfunded and ineffectual. The state of technology, of transportation, communication, medicine, agriculture, manufacturing, was barely more advanced than during the Middle Ages of Europe. Now, in 1908, with the population of America at almost 90 million, the federal revenue was 40 times greater than it had been a century earlier, and America was on a par with Britain and Germany as a global power. U.S. citizens enjoyed the highest per capita income in the world and were blessed with the marvels of railroads and automobiles, telegraph and telephone, electricity and gas. Banks of high-speed elevators zipped through vertical shafts of the tallest buildings on Earth. Pneumatic tubes whisked mail between far-flung post offices in minutes. Men shaved their whiskers with disposable razor blades, and women cleaned their homes with remarkable new devices called vacuums. Couples danced to the Victrola in the comfort of their living rooms and snuggled in dark theaters to watch the flickering images of the Vitagraph. Invisible words volleyed across the oceans between the giant antennas of Marconi's wireless telegraph, while American engineers cut a 50-mile canal through the Isthmus of Panama. From the glories of the present, the world turned to the question of the future. What will the year 2008 bring us? What marvels of development await the youth of tomorrow? The U.S. population of 2008 would be 472 million, predicted the world. We may have gyroscopic trains as broad as houses swinging at 200 miles an hour up steep grades and around dizzying curves. We may have aeroplanes winging the once inconquerable air. The tides that ebb and flow to waste may take the place of our spent coal and flash their strength by wire to every point of need. Who can say? Not a day passed without new discoveries and advances achieved or promised. This very New Year's Day, Dr. Simon Flexner of the Rockefeller Institute was publicly declaring his conviction, in a medical paper read at the University of Chicago, that human organ transplants would soon be common. Meanwhile, the very air seemed charged, it was actually, with the possibilities of the infant wireless technology. When the expectations of wireless experts are realized, everyone will have his own pocket telephone and may be called wherever he happens to be, Hampton's magazine daringly predicted in 1908. The citizen of the wireless age will walk abroad with a receiving apparatus, compactly arranged in his hat, and tuned to that one of myriad vibrations by which he has chosen to be called. When that invention is perfected, we shall have a new series of daily miracles. As a New Yorker, Terence would have been keenly aware of how abruptly daily miracles were transforming the modern world. The city provided an education in rapacious progress, evolving at the jumpy speed of a vitagraph picture, escalating toward some yet unwritten but marvelous destiny while accompanied by the tune of pounding rivet guns and 310,000 jangling telephones. 6 times more phones than in Paris, the New York Telephone Company bragged, and twice as many as in London. Though London remained the largest city in the world, New York was a close second, and twice as large as its nearest American competitor, Chicago, and still growing by leaps and bounds. The great city of New York is in that stage of its development in which it may be likened to a youth who is neither man nor boy, observed the New York Tribune later that January. It is in the transition stage. It has not yet lost the ungainliness and awkwardness of the growing youth. But every day can see fresh evidence of its coming symmetry, strength, and beauty. The population of the city had risen by 1 million inhabitants since Terence turned 9, and continued to grow at a rate of 90,000 per year. In 1907, the largest influx of immigrants in the nation's history, 1.29 million, had arrived on American shores, most of them sluicing through New York's Ellis Island, and many staying to settle in East Side tenements and add themselves to the enormity of the city. As the population grew, the city's infrastructure expanded at a mind-boggling rate. Terence was 12 when the longest and most intricate subway system in the world opened under the streets of New York. A year before that, the Williamsburg Bridge had opened, and since then, 2 new remarkable bridges, the Manhattan and the Queensborough, had been rising over the East River. Tunnel workers were meanwhile blasting and digging beneath both the East and North, Hudson, rivers. Within the next 2 months of 1908, 2 tunnels would open under the rivers, one to Brooklyn, the other to New Jersey. Back above ground, the Singer Building, the tallest skyscraper in the world, was nearly complete downtown. Already iron workers were raising the steel of a taller building, the 700-foot Metropolitan Life Tower on Madison Square. Like giant fingers, these towering new structures pointed insistently to the sky. Railroads and automobiles had penetrated the terrestrial interior. Subways and tunnels and mine shafts had delved into the subterranean, and now man would conquer air. Architects and visionaries imagined future metropolises of 1,000-foot towers connected by webs of high-altitude bridges and catwalks, of civilizations of airborne people who would live above the earth and traverse the crowded skies in various aircraft. A headline in that morning's Times echoed the prediction, "Many may fly in 1908." The newspaper quoted the French aviator, Henri Fermont, 12 months from now, we will have aeroplanes which will fly 10 or 12 miles easily without once touching the earth." It was an absurd, fantastic proposition. And yet, anything, everything was possible. If you doubted Thomas Edison's confident assessment, you might look to Harry Houdini for confirmation. The famed illusionist lived with his wife and mother at 278 West 113th Street, just down the block from where Terence was passing now. Inside his handsome brownstone, Houdini was putting the finishing touches on his latest act, the milk can escape, for a late January debut in St. Louis. But even Houdini's milk can escape paled next to the marvel of flying. Nothing really compared to flying. a point Houdini himself would concede when he purchased an airplane a few years later. Most Americans still considered airplane flight more of a fantastical dream than a practical reality in these early hours of 1908. The names of Wilbur and Orville Wright were only vaguely familiar, and those who knew of them had little reason to assume these taciturn bicycle mechanics from Dayton, Ohio, would emerge as victors in the race to the sky. How strange, then, that before the end of the year, the Wrights would be more celebrated than Houdini. More celebrated, in fact, than just about anyone on Earth. And the boy, who turned and leaned now, swooping across 110th Street to the park entrance, would learn the story, along with every other American, of how Wilbur Wright discovered the secret of aerial equilibrium by riding a bicycle. Terence would have entered the park from the northwest corner, turning east under the bare trees and joining the automobile traffic on the 6-mile loop of the Central Park Drive. Not long ago, the park had been restricted to bicycles and carriages, or, on snowy winter days, to horse-drawn sleighs. Within the last several years, automobiles had come to dominate the drive, and now they roared by Terence, their engines whining and smoking. Inside the open-bodied cars, parties of automobilists enjoyed a bracing holiday lark. The women sat snug in squirrel and ermine, their pink cheeks obscured by veils. The men hunkered in masculine bearskins and wore thick goggles over their eyes. Automobiles had been available in the country for 10 years, but were still largely vehicles of sport rather than of utility. And with newly acquired speeds of nearly a mile a minute, they assured an experience far more invigorating than any provided by a horse or bicycle or sleigh. By 1908, speed limits were in effect on city streets, but drivers tended to ignore them. Speeding, or scorching, was an integral component of the sport. An ad for Dewar Scotch in Harper's Weekly succinctly captured the devil-may-care attitude of drivers in the early part of the century. An automobile soars over a hill as a gleeful menage frolics within the open chassis. One of the passengers is reaching back over his shoulder into a basket, pulling out a bottle. "There is no more exhilarating sport or recreation than automobiling," reads the ad copy. "The pleasure of a spin over country roads or through city parks is greatly enhanced if the basket is well stocked with Dewar Scotch White Label." Over 200,000 cars would ply American roads by the end of 1908, most produced by the 500 or so American automobile manufacturers that had sprung up since 1901. The vast majority of these companies would soon go out of business, devoured or made obsolete by larger companies. For the moment, though, automobiles came in an array of Whites and Waynes and Haynes, of Stearns and Moores and Bakers, of Pierces and Popes and Thomases, an endless list of eponymous entrepreneurs who had seen the motorized future but would have no place in it. They came in every shade and shape, these automobiles, but the fashionable color was red and the prevailing size was large. As Collier's humorist George Fitch would describe it later in the year, the ideal automobile of 1908 included room for 7 people, a whist table, half a ton of lunch, a cord of golf sticks, a barrel of gasoline, half a peck of small bills for fine money, and a kit of embalming tools in case of emergency. The embalming tools, Collier's readers understood, were to handle the mess of human casualties that automobiles routinely strewed in their wakes. If automobiling was still sport, it was clear by the start of 1908 that it was an exceedingly dangerous sport. We have become so perfectly accustomed to being whirled along at the rate of 60 miles an hour in our luxuriously appointed motors and private cars that we fail to recognize the positively death-dealing agents of destruction which we are driving through thickly populated streets or along narrow country roads. Warned a New York Times editorial in January of 1908. Later in the year, Scientific American provided an alarmingly opaque explanation of the forces that made automobiles so lethal. The kinetic energy which a projectile possesses in virtue of its mass and velocity is necessarily expended in destructive action when the flight of the projectile is suddenly arrested by an obstacle of any sort. The destructive effects are divided between the projectile and the obstacle in the inverse ratio of their respective powers to resist deformation. All of which seemed to mean that when an automobile came into contact with a smaller object, the smaller object was doomed. Not everybody considered automobiles health hazards. Indeed, many physicians and health officials looked to them as a salvation from the grime and disease that plagued cities. Not only did they offer the benefits of a restorative drive in the fresh air of the countryside, but they also promised cleaner air within the cities. To understand how anyone could have believed automobiles a remedy to air pollution, it helps to recall that more than 120,000 horses tramped the streets of New York in 1908, and that each of these horses dropped about 22 pounds of manure a day, for a total daily deposit of over 2,640,000 pounds. When the manure dried, it drifted through the air as a thick dust that infected nasal passages and respiratory tracts. A writer in Appleton's magazine blamed 20,000 deaths a year on horse dung in 1908. The automobile, he wrote, would overcome the absurdities of a horse-infected city. Whatever their impact on air pollution and public health, the real disagreement about automobiles was driven more by economic status than by environmental concerns. Automobile owners tended to be wealthy as a matter of tautology. Since most models cost between $2,000 and $4,000, 2 to 4 years of salary for one of the working men who lived in Terrence's neighborhood, only the well-off could afford to buy them. The fact that the machines brought out the worst excesses of the rich, confirming what many Americans already believed about them, they were callous, feckless, selfish, and ridiculous, added to the resentment of those who couldn't afford them. Nothing has spread a socialistic feeling in this country more than the use of the automobile, a picture of the arrogance of wealth, declared Woodrow Wilson, the president of Princeton University, in 1906, airing a view that was as reasonable as it was wrong. Wilson, like many others, failed to take into account the ripening attraction of the automobile, fatal or not, to all classes of Americans. Before the end of 1908, a 45-year-old Michigan native named Henry Ford would begin manufacturing a revolutionary new machine that would be so affordable, so dependable and useful, that few Americans of any class would be able to resist its charms. By the time Wilson became president of the United States in 1912, even socialists would be driving Model Ts. Terrence was pedaling hard now through the northern reaches of Central Park, the grade of the drive rising under him in a long, ascending S. The automobiles would be chugging past him, their tires spewing bits of oiled gravel, their engines venting smoke. In the gloaming of late afternoon, a few drivers had probably turned on their glaring acetylene headlights to better see the way under the trees. Terrence, the boy who vowed to take no one's dust, would rise from the seat of his bicycle, tilting forward, his legs pumping and his skin prickling. Of course, it was impossible for him to overtake an automobile on the rise of the steepest hill in Central Park. Then again, who's to say? Maybe he convinced himself he could do it. Maybe he focused intently on the tonneau of the automobile in front of him and decided to show its occupants a thing or two about speed. Inside the car, a chauffeur was at the wheel. A family sat in the back. From the corner of his eye, Terence might have gauged that they were wealthy even by the standards of automobile owners. He would have noticed the haughty prep school boys, home from Groton for the holidays, and the daughter sitting primly in ermine. One of the girls was 15. Maybe she turned, and her eyes met his, issuing a challenge he couldn't refuse. What happened next is unclear. News accounts vary. In one, the automobile confronted heavy traffic and abruptly stopped. In another account, the chauffeur, changing lanes to pass another car, pulled out in front of Terence. As it was slowing down, the Kigo boy crashed into the tonneau, is how the Times reported it. The Herald was slightly more graphic. Running into the rear of the automobile, Tigo was thrown forward, striking the car. The World, typically the most colorful of the lot, painted a fuller, though not necessarily more accurate, picture. Tigo put on steam, and as he rounded a turn, crashed into the rear wheel of the auto and was hurled to the ground. The result, in any case, was the same. Terence Kigo, or Tigo, lay unconscious at the rear of the automobile. The back door of the automobile opened and a man with a mustache and bowler stepped out. The man was no longer young, but not so old as to require the cane he customarily carried. He was largely built, but soft, almost diffident, as he set his foot onto the macadam. He might have looked vaguely familiar to other automobilists who witnessed the accident and paused to rubberneck. His name was J.P. Morgan Jr., or simply Jack to those who knew him. Jack Morgan was a man who turned few heads in his own right. His father, though, was among the most celebrated men in the world, and never more celebrated than now. In the wake of the financial panic a few months earlier, J.P. Morgan Sr. had been credited with single-handedly saving Wall Street and restoring faith in the American economy. Even before this recent triumph, numerous regal encomiums had been attached to him. He was the Duke, the Zeus, the Pope of Wall Street. These days, most often, he was simply the King. Like his larger-than-life father, Jack Morgan was a tall, burly man. His facial features were similar to his father's, too, though he lacked his father's fantastically florid nose and piercing dark eyes. He lacked his father's iron will and imperious temperament, too. He had lived in the great man's shadow for so long that he was, at 41, something of a shadow man. He was also, though, a millionaire many times over. And if his father was king, then he, only son and heir apparent of the House of Morgan, was de facto prince. Jack Morgan walked over to the boy, stooping slightly, as he always did. Terence lay unconscious on the ground, his eyes closed but his chest heaving in shallow breaths. With the help of his chauffeur, Jack Morgan carried the boy to the roadside and laid him down. Then, according to the New York Press, he did something his regal father would never have done. The millionaire knelt down and placed the boy's head on his knee. Together, they waited for help to arrive. Internal combustion. all the remarkable new possibilities available to Americans at the start of 1908 did not undo some hard realities. When a boy on a bike collided with an automobile, the result was, as Scientific American had explained, predictably bad for the boy on the bike. And if, metaphorically speaking, America at the start of 1908 was a boy with a full heart and high hopes, the country was also a kind of pitiless machine. Machine metaphors were fashionable in the early 20th century. A few months before Terence took his New Year's Day bicycle ride, the writer and historian Henry Adams had self-published a book, The Education of Henry Adams, in which he described a revelation he'd experienced standing before a row of dynamos at the Paris Exposition of 1900. These gargantuan electricity-generating machines overwhelmed Adams. To him, the dynamo itself was but an ingenious channel for conveying somewhere the heat latent in a few tons of poor coal hidden in a dirty engine house carefully kept out of sight, wrote Adams, describing his thoughts in the third person. As he grew accustomed to the great gallery of machines, he began to feel the 40-foot dynamos as a moral force, much as the early Christians felt the cross. Adams had stumbled upon what was for him a perfect representation of the churning, gnashing power of the modern age that made people like him feel painfully obsolete. At 70, it is hard not to take one's helplessness seriously. He wrote to his old friend, Supreme Court Justice Oliver Wendell Holmes, on New Year's Eve, 1907, the day before Terence's ride in the park. It's fitting that the device Adams used to convey his obsolescence was already a bit fusty by the time he published The Education. Electricity had been a fact of life in America since 1882, the year Thomas Edison wired Lower Manhattan with direct current. Urban Americans were taking it more or less for granted by the early 1900s. Dynamos were impressively large and mesmerizing in their power. But compared to other rapidly advancing technologies of the early 20th century, they were dinosaurs. The interest of Americans had been captured by a newer, smaller technology of the internal combustion engine. The internal combustion engine was, and still is, the hidden mechanism that allowed automobiles to move. About 10% of automobiles ran on steam or electricity in 1908, but the gasoline-powered engine was the clear future of automotive technology. It was also the engine that had sent the Wright brothers aloft in 1903 and would, in short order, allow humans to fly through the air at will. The internal combustion engine hadn't been invented in America, but by 1907 had already proved to be the most significant technological innovation in American history. Its metaphorical possibilities were as potent as its physical properties. An internal combustion engine, like any engine, is a transformative medium, ingesting one kind of energy, in this case the dormant explosiveness of gasoline, and releasing another. As gasoline detonates in the confines of a compression chamber, the force of its explosion pushes a piston, which turns a crankshaft, which spins the wheels. Energy isn't created, it's converted from a fuel into a force. America at the start of the 20th century was such an engine of conversion. Certain forms of energy went in, other forms came out. The fuel that entered the machine was, of course, the natural resources cut and dug from its land. Crops, timber, coal, petroleum. But it was also the human labor that harvested these resources and fed them into the machine. the millions of American men and boys toiling in coal mines and steel mills, in cotton and tobacco fields, the women and girls in sweatshops and textile factories. The working poor gave nearly all their waking lives to labor, 10 or 12 hours a day with only Sundays off, for $12 or $15 a week. In addition to being physically demanding and low-paying, much industrial work was extremely dangerous. Altogether, about 35,000 American workers died on the job annually in the first decade of the 20th century, about 96 per day, and another 500,000 were injured, giving America one of the highest worker accident rates in the world. Adding an all-too-literal twist to the machine metaphor, laborers were sometimes consumed, fuel-like, by acts of combustion. In steel mills, molten pig iron slopped over the lips of casks, or casks fractured, flooding mills with flaming liquid metal and roasting men alive. In coal mines, gases trapped in deep shafts exploded, igniting in turn the coal dust floating through the air. Over 3,000 miners had been killed in American mines in 1907. December alone had been astonishingly deadly. 4 accidents, 2 of these in Pennsylvania, another in Alabama, another in West Virginia, had killed 694 miners. In the last accident, on December 19th in Monongah, West Virginia, 362 men and boys had perished. To this day, Monongah remains the worst mining disaster in U.S. history. Naturally, workers sometimes balked at performing difficult, dangerous work for long hours and low wages. Occasionally, they organized strikes. But strikes tended to go poorly for workers, requiring them to endure weeks or months without pay, only to find themselves unemployed in the end. A man unable or reluctant to do his job was easily replaced by another man happy to fill his shoes for less money and with less complaint. Generally, this other man was one of the immigrants pouring into America at a rate of 3,500 a day. Immigrants didn't get much respect or affection from native-born Americans. On the contrary, they were roundly disparaged as filthy, criminally inclined, and genetically inferior. But it was they, the foreign-born workers who made up 60% of the nation's heavy industry labor force, who were the secret weapon of American industry. They kept wages low, worked diligently and willingly, and, unlike the nation's coal or iron reserves, were apparently inexhaustible. Into the engine, then, went inexpensive labor, and out came wealth. Tremendous, unfathomable wealth. Wealth on a scale enjoyed by few humans in history. A portion of this wealth was distributed throughout the population as wages and consumer spending, giving Americans the highest per capita income of any nation on Earth. Much of it, though, was funneled directly into the hands of the tiny minority who had a stake in the profits of the country's chief industries. The 2% of the population, that is, who owned 60% of America's wealth. Then, as now, the rich found ever grander, ever stranger ways to display their wealth. The social critic, Thorstein Veblen, had earlier described the spending habits of the rich as conspicuous consumption. A younger critic of the rich, Upton Sinclair, fresh off the great success of his 1906 muckraking novel, The Jungle, wrote vividly of such consumption in his 1908 follow-up, The Metropolis. Sinclair's characters squander astonishing sums of money on fashionable clothing, drive automobiles at reckless speeds, stuff themselves with sickening feasts, divert themselves with freak fets, lavish parties that often featured bizarre costumes and entertainments, and utter such observations as, "The trouble with poor people, it seems to me, is that there are so many of them." Sinclair overlooked one curious custom of the rich that year. This was the performance of so-called tableaux. To stage a tableau, a wealthy socialite would invite several other wealthy socialites to dress up as famous historical figures from paintings. The socialites would appear on a stage before an audience of peers, holding significant and attractive poses in the footlights. In one tableau that winter of 1908, arranged by Mrs. Waldorf Astor at the Plaza Hotel, Mrs. James B. Eustel presented herself as Flaubert's Salammbô. She wore a blue sapphire robe and a 45-pound live boa constrictor draped over her shoulders. With admirable discipline, she maintained her pose without flinching. The only thing moving was the snake. It's tempting to read secret yearnings into these taxidermic theatricals. A desire for stillness dressed as history. A wish to freeze time amid the hurly-burly of the modern city. Life for the rich was not all a drive in the park. They struggled with the knowledge that their financial status was tenuous and contingent on the relentlessly dynamic American economy. The 1907 panic served to remind them that wealth could be snatched away in a few bad weeks on Wall Street. So as they sat in the Plaza ballroom in silence and watched the snake twist around the torso of Mrs. James B. Eustel, they had to wonder how, having achieved position at the very top of the American pyramid, they could be sure to keep it. How might they guarantee that their perch in the social order remained as it was? They required a certificate of status more permanent than anything America could confer. The kind of status only European nobility enjoyed. They required, in other words, titles. Hence the peculiar institution known as the international marriage. By the terms of international marriage, a rich American heiress would be married off to a less rich European noble. He got wealth, she got title, and everybody was happy. Or more likely, not so happy, as the unions continued to be doomed. Sociologists and statisticians have been wasting data to demonstrate that marriages of this kind are invariably productive of misery, mused the Saturday Evening Post in its first issue of 1908. Despite such warnings, the practice showed no signs of abating. The young heiress, Gladys Vanderbilt, whose cousin Consuelo was already in a failing international marriage to the 9th Duke of Marlborough, was to be married to a Hungarian count at the end of January of 1908. The daughter of Senator Elkins of West Virginia was secretly engaged, or so it was not so secretly reported in the press, to the Duke of Abruzzi. In February, another heiress, Theodora Schontz, was to marry the penniless Duke de Chalons. 2 months after that wedding, the Duke would die in a Paris hotel room from an overdose of cocaine and morphine. And on it went, misery or no. Every day, thousands of poor European immigrants arrived in New York Harbor in steerage to begin their new lives of laboring at a dollar or two a day. And every few weeks, aboard one of those very same Cunard or White Star liners, only now, of course, several decks above in first class, out went the product of their labor, back to the European continent in the pampered and bejeweled form of a newly minted duchess or countess. upon these great ocean steamliners coming and going, the American machine achieved its most pure expression. In the Park. Darkness fell on the first day of 1908 in New York City. 20 minutes had passed since the boy on the bicycle rammed into the back of the automobile in Central Park. But still no ambulance came for the boy. Terence remained unconscious, his head resting on Jack Morgan's knee. The accident that brought them together was already dimming in the shadows. The next morning, 4 newspapers would carry brief items about the accident, each reporting it slightly differently. Given that accounts disagree on the name of the boy, as well as on the precise location and circumstances of the accident, it's fair to wonder at the accuracy of the whole story. The facts do not quite add up. If the automobile and the bicycle were both climbing the longest, steepest hill in Central Park, how did a 16-year-old boy riding a simple-gear bicycle gain enough speed, and therefore sufficient force, to slam into the back of an automobile hard enough to knock himself out? No one who has gasped up this hill on an 18-speed 21st-century bike will easily understand. At the risk of impugning the American press corps circa 1908, it should be pointed out that newspaper owners sometimes adjusted their news to suit J.P. Morgan Sr., on the grounds that the financier might pull their operations out from under them if they displeased him. There is a reasonable chance, in other words, that it wasn't the boy who hit the car, but the car that hit the boy, and that the facts of the case were made to fit the laws of finance more accurately than they fit the laws of physics. Then again, maybe it happened just as it was told. Maybe the boy really did climb the hill so fast, with such speed and determination, that he really did slam into the back of the car with enough force to throw himself unconscious to the ground. Anything, everything, is possible. A police deputy finally arrived on the scene of the accident in an automobile and took the boy away with him to a hospital in Harlem. Jack Morgan left the park with his family, off to assume his destiny as the president of Morgan & Company. He was a responsible and dutiful son, hardly one of Upton Sinclair's rich wastrels, but his life would not be an entirely happy one. He would be forever haunted by the knowledge, his and others, that he did not measure up to his father's imperious standards. As for Terence Teago, or Keigo, whoever he was, he regained consciousness after arriving at the hospital, shocked and bruised, but otherwise no worse for wear. He then promptly vanished from history. There is no record of what became of him in the 20th century. Chapter 2. Thin Ice. January 6th through January 31st. From the New York Times, February 1st, 1908. Beaver Falls, Pennsylvania, January 31st. Locked in each other's arms, Miss Zella Wiley, aged 19, daughter of the Reverend R.C. Wiley, pastor of the First Reformed Presbyterian Church of Wilkinsburg, Pennsylvania, and R.C. Patterson, aged 21, of Greensburg, went down to death under the ice of the Beaver River this afternoon. Through the clear ice, the bodies of Patterson and Miss Wiley could be seen at the bottom of the river. Americans of 1908 were, in theory anyway, a prim people, constrained by rules of dress and decorum that would strike their grandchildren and great-grandchildren as ludicrously restrictive. They wore clothing that was heavy, hot, and impractical. Women suffered spine-contorting corsets, covered by 7 or 8 layers of fabric, and dragged around skirts that nearly scraped the ground. Men boxed themselves into square-shouldered 3-piece suits, complete with waistcoats they seldom removed, even in midsummer, and high stiff collars that grasped their necks. For both sexes, hats were all but obligatory out of doors, and women frequently draped veils from their hat brims to cover their faces. Fresh air seldom touched human flesh. Bound in their wardrobes, most American men and women entering the 20th century continued to observe Victorian rules of social interaction, rules that were mainly meant to keep them apart. Recreational sex was strictly prohibited. Women were expected to remain chaste until their wedding night, and then suffer intercourse only to fulfill their sacred and patriotic obligation to populate the earth with more Americans. Men might enjoy the act. They couldn't help themselves, but were expected to feel ashamed of their more bestial natures afterward. Young mothers were harangued to be ever vigilant for evidence of masturbation in their children. One popular parenting guide provided an exhaustive catalog of warning signs. Should you discover your child listless and preferring solitude rather than companionship, averse to exercise, averted looks, nervous, hypochondriacal, restless in sleep, constipated, pain in the back and lower extremities in the morning, appetite vacillating, hands cold and clammy. If you have already been suspicious, watch carefully now, even though not half these symptoms are present. The New York State Insane Asylum, warned the book's author, was filled with habitual masturbators. A wonder it wasn't filled with hysterical young mothers. Sex wasn't the only sensual pleasure that raised hackles. Moving pictures, that new entertainment to which the masses had taken with a passion starting around 1905, were condemned by ministers and concerned citizens as immoral and dangerous, appealing as they did to baser instincts. Liquor, too, was much maligned. Half the states in the Union had enacted temperance laws, most recently Georgia, which went completely dry on New Year's Day of 1908. Even Sunday comic supplements came under scrutiny from educational leaders who worried they might corrupt America's youth with undue silliness. Altogether, Americans of 1908 believed they lived in an age in which humans could and should master the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.